Good morning.
Morning.
Welcome to South Haven First United Methodist Church at 723 Star Landing Road East. Good to see everyone in the house of the Lord this morning, and it's especially good to have those of you who are watching us online this morning. We're glad that you could participate in our worship service with us this morning. A few announcements this morning. First of all, if you have not, it's first of the month, if you haven't put your tithe and offering in the plates by the door, I invite you to do so. If you're watching online this morning, you can mail yours to the church, and Jerry will have the address on the screen this morning behind me. I want to remind you about next Sunday, there is a leadership committee meeting, and those members are listed on the screen this morning who need to attend, and that meeting will be at 3 o'clock. That's what we used to call the old nominations committee. So, it's hard to believe charge conference time is coming up. And this is September, and that's usually in November. So, it's that time of the year where we have to get things done and take care of items on the agenda. Also coming up on Saturday the 19th of September, our fall festival will be held here at the church, so make your plans to attend that event. And birthdays this week, Ryan Tucker has a birthday. Anniversaries this week, we have three coming up. Jackie and Angie Jackson have an anniversary, Mark and Susie Moore, and Les and Rita Kruger. So if you see these people, be sure and wish them happy anniversary. Any other announcements this morning from the congregation? Not? Let's sing this morning. It's a beautiful day outside, and it's a gorgeous day inside. So our first hymn is number 64. Holy, holy, holy. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Church for allowing me to take off last week. But Sandy and I have been away with some dear friends, and I want to thank not just Jerry, but also Bill and Jim and Beth Ellen stepping up and taking leadership roles in the service and helping out, covering everything while I was away. But I did look, and it was funny looking, on Facebook to see me up there on that screen. So anyway, thank you all for allowing me to be away for a week's time, but greater still, it's good to be home. As we go into our time of prayer, As always, we want to continue lifting up all the needs of so many different individuals within the life of our church. And for those of you who are at home, if you would like to have an updated prayer list, you know, you're always welcome to contact us at the church. We'll mail you one, email one. You who are here with us physically in person, if you'd like one, just let Jerry know. We can make a copy this morning if you need an updated prayer list. So please contact us. Let us know. We'd love to help you out in this way. But we always continue to lift up these needs and so many other needs here within our community and within our nation. So much stuff still going on, but our God is still great and He's powerful. He's still sitting on His throne. And we as God's people just still got to be faithful and continue to giving ourselves, giving our city and our state and our nation to Him, seeking His help and guidance. And so I invite you to continue to do that, to lift all these needs up of people affected by the coronavirus, all the other stuff that's happening, all of our doctors and nurses, the first responders, essential workers, and so many other things, along with our police officers and the firefighters and the men and women of the armed forces. Continue to pray for them as we pray for our president and for all of our elected officials. Because we need God. We need to give all these needs as we give ourselves now. So I invite you, if you will, to please now just take a moment. And whatever it is, whoever it is that God is laying on your heart, take this a few moments here just to pray now. And give yourself and give this service to God as Beth Ellen's going to play and take us now together to the throne of grace. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we do come into Your presence because we do know that through it all, we can depend upon You. We can depend upon Your love for us. We can depend upon Your Word that are words of life and love and grace and mercy and forgiveness. And so we come here in this time of service to give ourselves and to place all this now, this service, into Your loving, life-giving hands. To use everything that is a part of this time. From all the music that is shared and lifted up to the words that are given. And use it all for one purpose, and that is to draw us closer to You. And to bring us as one to the foot of the cross of Jesus. Continue to be with all the other needs, dear God. Our loved ones, friends, and family members who cannot be here physically with us, but are with us spiritually right now. Touch them in the same way You're blessing us. Let them also feel Your Spirit move through them as they are in worship with us. And continue now to just bless all these needs, all the things that You keep laying on our hearts, knowing You're the one that is still in control, and You're the one that is still in the business of answering our prayers. And we ask You now, dear God, to please answer this biggest prayer of all. To answer within our lives now and within our hearts this prayer that Jesus Himself has given to us. So hear us now and help us to hear You in response as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen and amen.
What will it be like when my pain is gone? It's all the worries of this world just fade away. What will it be like when you call my name? In that moment when I see you face to face, I'm waiting my whole life to hear you say, well done, well done, a good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well.
Thank you so much. I want to continue on now in our service and share with you from the book of Hebrews found in the New Testament. And I want to share with you from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 29 through 35. And I want to ask those of you who are gathered here in person, would you now please stand for the reading of God's holy word? So once again, Hebrews 11, verses 29 through 35. It was by faith that the people of Israel went right through the Red Sea as though they were on dry ground. But when the Egyptians tried to follow, they were all drowned. It was by faith that the people of Israel marched around Jericho for 7 days, and the walls came crashing down. It was by faith that Rahab the prostitute was not destroyed with the people in her city who refused to obey God, for she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. How much more do I need to say? It would take too long to recount the stories of faith of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and all the prophets. By faith, these people overthrew kingdoms, ruled with justice, and received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of lions, quenched the flames of fire, and escaped death by the edge of the sword. Their weakness was turned to strength. They became strong in battle and put whole armies to flight. Women received their loved ones back again from death. But others were tortured, refusing to turn from God in order to be set free. They placed their hope in a better life after the resurrection. May God bless the reading and the hearing of His holy word. And all of God's people together said, amen. Amen. God bless you and thank you. Please be seated and let us pray. Once again, Heavenly Father, we are here in Your presence, thanking You for being our God. Thanking You for sending Your Son Jesus here into this world. And also thanking You for the power that comes when Your Holy Spirit fills our lives. And as we are gathered here now, anoint us once again with the power of Your Spirit. Open our hearts and our minds to You and You alone. And through the power of Your Spirit, anoint us in such a way that we don't worry about the things left undone this past week. And we're not going to focus on the things that are still left to be done this upcoming week. Instead, through the power of Your Spirit, help us now just to focus upon You, to just relax and just feel Your presence in a great and mighty way. And as always, dear God, I'm not ashamed to pray for that double portion, because I need it, dear God. Because as I stand before You, before Your church, as I speak, I do not want Your church to hear me. Instead, I want them to hear the voice of Jesus. But greater still, as I stand before Your church, those here in person in Your church, those who are watching online, that as they look this way, that they will not see me, but instead they will see Jesus now, alive and standing before them. And so, dear God, bless us now. You lead us, and once again, You direct us. And I ask all this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. There was once this preacher who lived in the state of Wyoming, and he was invited to come to the state of Montana and lead a revival service that was going to be held during the very first week of April. Well, the preacher accepted the invitation, but instead of deciding to be flown over by airplane like they offered, he decided he wanted to drive it. He wanted to make it a drive, because after all, the revival being held in the month of April, all the snow and ice will be gone, and it'll be just a beautiful, relaxing drive. But as you might guess, the night before the pastor was to leave, a rare snowstorm hit the area. But the pastor, he wasn't discouraged. He decided that he could still make the trip in time to be there before the services started. So early that morning, he headed out, with the snow still coming down. But as he got about halfway through his trip, suddenly he noticed, and the snow had picked up. and soon it became a blizzard. He could barely see the road in front of him, but worse off, he had no idea where he was. But then he sees the lights of a snowplow. And he instantly decides that the best thing, the safest thing that he can do is just to follow that snowplow. Stay in close behind it, follow that snowplow until the storm let up and he could see where he was. Well, about an hour later after following the snowplow, suddenly the snowplow stopped and the driver got out. He walked back to the preacher's car, and as he did, he motioned to him to roll down his window. He then asked the preacher, "Why have you been following me all this time?" Well, the pastor explained what was going on and why he had been following him. And the driver then, he simply looked at the pastor and said, "Well, preacher, I'm sorry. I hate to tell you this, but you'll never get to Montana following me while I'm plowing this parking lot." Have you ever been lost? Have you ever lost your sense of direction? Or have you ever started out on a trip and in your head, in your heart, you knew exactly how to get there, but suddenly, somewhere around halfway, suddenly you realize you have no idea where you are? Well, in our scripture reading for today, I'm sharing with you the closing words that are found in probably the most well-read, best-known chapters found throughout the entire Bible. We know what this is. It's called the Great Faith Chapter. Now, for me, one of the things that's always so made this chapter stand out is the fact that as the preacher, you know, the author of Hebrews, as he is describing these great people of faith, that for me, what he's doing is more than just describing them. What he's doing, he is telling us in this chapter. He is describing for us their journey. Not just their faith, but their journey. The journey of faith that they took. The journey that they were led to go on by the faith that they had. And it's a journey of faith that he lets us know from the very beginning. A journey of faith that can only be made with three steps. With the steps of hope, trust, and assurance. But here's the problem. The thing is this. That if we have no direction to our faith, then our faith will take us no farther than our own parking lot. That's why this is important this morning. Why what I read to you is so important, because the preacher is continuing on in the story here. And he shares with us more now than just three steps of faith. He is now sharing with us what I want to call the three steps of faith that give direction to our journey. He is sharing with us the three steps that will lead us. Lead us in the way of faith that we are called to go each day of our lives. So what are these three steps? Well, the first one is found in what I would call verse 29. Verse 29, I say, it's the step of the stream of faith. Now, in this verse, we see the conclusion of Moses' story of faith, which actually begins back in verse 23. But as we read here, the preacher describes for us a faith. A faith that was so strong that it did what? That it not only parted a sea full of water. He is also describing for us a faith found in Moses that was so strong that it also reached out. It reached out and it covered all the people of Israel. And it was a faith that kept them safe as they made that journey. As they made their journey through that parted sea. But when it comes to truly understanding Moses, when it comes to truly understanding the faith of Moses, the best thing we need to do is look at the faith he had back in the first part of his life. The first steps of faith that he took. Because if you know Moses' story, if you remember, Moses did not start out with a strong faith. Remember how when God called him into Egypt, the excuses that Moses came up with? First off, he tells God, well, I'm shy. I don't like getting up in front of people. He then tells him, well, if I get up in front of people, I'm unable to speak in public. I just can't do it. And then the third thing is, he begins to tell God, well, you know, why I can't speak in public is that I have a speech impediment. Basically, he stuttered. Now, when I think about these three things concerning Moses, I immediately think about a man named Reverend Roman Miller. Brother Miller was my college professor that I had at Wesley College. And I believe that Brother Miller had a greater influence on me than any other professor that I have. I love this man. First off, I love the faith. But most importantly, I loved it. I loved his ability to preach. Because he was this little short man. But when he got up to preach, his voice was strong. It was powerful. It was bold and it was loud. I loved to hear that man preach. That's why I didn't believe him. I thought he was pulling our leg. So I didn't believe him when he first told our class one day that growing up, he stuttered. And he too had a speech impediment. And that's why when God called him into ministry, he told God, I can't preach. I stutter. You know that. But then he looked at us. And he said, but God spoke to him. He told us that if God called him into ministry, that God told him, don't worry. I'm going to take care of your stuttering. He said to trust him because he was going to do a mighty work of faith in his life. A mighty work that would strengthen the faith in his life. And then he told us about the first time that he ever stepped up to a pulpit and the fear that he had. That his fear the first time to step up to preach wasn't the same fear that all of us other preachers have. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I'll let you know something. Any preacher that tells you the truth here on this will tell you that when you step up for the first time to preach, your biggest fear is that you're going to forget what you were supposed to say. It's still my biggest fear. I have nightmares. I'll wake up in a cold sweat because I had a dream in which I was standing in front of you and couldn't remember. I wasn't ready. I wasn't prepared. That wasn't his fear. Of course, you know, his fear was that when he got up, that he wouldn't be able to talk, that he wouldn't be able to speak and say what he wanted to say because he couldn't preach because he was stuttering so bad. But he told us that when he stepped up to that pulpit, that he could feel God begin to loosen his tongue. And he said he began to preach, and that from that moment on, he hasn't stopped preaching sins. That's why for me, verse 34 is the verse that should stand out in all of this. There in verse 34, the preacher tells us, their weakness was turned to strength. Their weakness was turned to strength. You see, our faith gets its strength when we do what? When we give God our weaknesses. When you are willing to say, God, here are my weaknesses. Here are my failures. And you give God your weaknesses, that's when He will give you strength. The strength of faith that will then help you. You can then part the seeds. You can part the seeds that want to fill up your life, that pull you under, that want to cause you to drown. You get that faith to part those seeds when you give them your weakness. And friends, trust me, I know what I'm talking about here. You can believe 100% what I'm saying to each and every one of you right now. Because you see, just like Moses, just like Brother Miller, I too grew up shy and with a stutter. Because of my stutter, I was a shy little boy, always hiding behind my mother's dress. Always shy, never talking to anybody. And maybe because not only did I stutter, but I also had a speech impediment. When it came to my THs, instead of saying things like numbers like 3 or 33, I would say 3 and 33. And my poor sister Rita, I couldn't say my R's. And then the afternoons after school. When I would get through with my classes and I was told by mom and dad to wait outside the school building for Rita to come and she would get me and walk me home. And her friends would come along and they'd look at me, stop looking at me and say, who are you waiting for? And I look up, I'm waiting for Rita. I'm sorry, Rita. I know that they gave her a hard time about that. But you see, I'm here today, aren't I? Not just preaching in front of you, but I'm preaching in front of others that are watching this live. Why? Because just like Moses, just like Brother Miller, I gave my weaknesses to God. And the question is, do you want to have strength in your faith? Do you want to have strength in your faith today to go forth and do what you're called to do? The thing is, I'm not saying you're going to be called to come up here and stand in front of people and preach. But God has called me to do other things, isn't He? How many times have you not stepped out because your faith wasn't strong enough? Do you want strength in your faith? Then all you've got to do is one thing, that's give your weaknesses to God. And that gives you direction to your faith. So that's the first one. What would be the second one? There in verse 30 is what I call the step of the watchfulness of faith. It gives us direction. Now here the preacher tells us about Joshua's journey of faith. Now in the Bible we know how he follows Moses and becomes not just the leader of the Jewish people, he also was given the title the commander of God's army. But I believe that if we should just meet with Joshua, if he was to somehow come to be with us today and we would ask him about this, he would just laugh and say, well, I'm nothing more than a buck private when it comes to the plans of God. That's why for me the story about Joshua that has always stood out, that means the most to me, it's not the story about the walls of Jericho came tumbling down. The story that has always impressed me is not the one where Joshua calls out to God, asking Him to keep the sun still in the sky until He can destroy His enemies. Those are great stories, but that's not what impresses me. The story that impresses me about Joshua is that moment. That he is there in the camp and suddenly word reaches him. That the true commander, the one true commander of God's army is now in the camp. And Joshua goes out, but when he meets him, he doesn't stand eye to eye. He doesn't stand shoulder to shoulder as one commander to another. Instead, he did what? You remember? He fell to his knees. He fell to his knees before the one true commander. You see, the thing that made Joshua stand out truly in his faith is that he had a faith that was strong enough for him to do something. To do the one thing that we all need to do in our lives so many times. You see, because of his faith, Joshua, he was strong enough to be able to get out of God's way and let God do his thing. He had a faith that was strong enough. He stepped to the side and let God do all the work. You see, friends, the truth is there are times, and there are times when God needs us to step out with a faith of strength. To have strength in our faith to go forth and do the things that He's calling us to do, that He needs us to do. But that's not the thing that happens most often, is it? Most of the time in our lives, the faith that God calls us to have is to have the faith that's strong enough for us to just step out of the way and just watch God. To step out and watch God and let God go to work as only God can do. To have a true faith of strength in which you're strong enough to get yourself out of the way. To step out of the way and watch God as He starts tearing down the walls. Tearing down the walls of sin and anger and hatred and jealousy and hurt and pain in your life. That's a beautiful step of faith. And it's what gives direction to our faith. To have a watchfulness of faith. To trust in God. And then there's the third one. There, verse 31, is what I call the step
of the acceptance of faith.
Now, in this story, you know, first we have the story of Rahab. And we know Rahab, she is much more than just a Moabite woman. She is much more than just a non-Jewish woman. She is worst of all. She's a harlot, a prostitute.
But you see, she had heard.
She had heard all the stories about the one true God who watched over Israel, who fought for Israel, who led Israel into the promised land. And unlike all the leaders and the citizens of Jericho who still chose not to believe, Rahab believed. Rahab chose to believe. And in spite of the fact that she was considered to be someone who was the lowest of the low by the people of her time, God used her. God used her to bring about His purpose into this world. But that purpose was not the saving of the spies or the destruction of the city of Jericho. No, it was a greater purpose than that. A greater purpose that is found in Matthew chapter 1. If you're familiar with Matthew, you know what chapter 1 is basically about. It's a listing of the genealogy of Jesus. And those of you who have studied this with me, you know that there in verse 5 of chapter 1, when you read that verse, the name Rahab just leaps off the page. What is so special about that? You see, we discover that what God actually did was He used a Moabite woman. He used a non-Jewish woman. He used a harlot. He used a prostitute to do what? To bring about His work. His plan of salvation into this world. But what does that really tell us? It tells us what? That God didn't use Rahab because of who she was. He used her because of her faith. Of her faithfulness. He looked past all the cracks and all the flaws. See, God doesn't care about that. He receives us, warts, dirt, all. He didn't look at that with Rahab. Instead, He saw a woman of faith. And He used that faith. And He accepted her. The greater still is the fact that she accepted God to be her God. To be the one true God that would fill her life. It was a faith of acceptance. And when I think about this, I think about myself. And by the time I stand in front of a mirror, now I look at myself in that mirror, and I can't help but ask myself this question, that since God can bring all this about in the life of a harlot, then why can't He do it in my life as well? What am I holding back from God? Or better yet, maybe this question. And since God can use the faith of a harlot, then what does that say about my faith? What does that say about all of our faith? What is our excuse when the woman who had been rejected can step out on faith and be used by God to bring salvation into this world? What does that say about our faith today? So what does all this mean for us then? These three steps in taking the journey of faith in our life. Now, I'm going to close this with a story that God laid on my heart. It was in a file, I should say, in the back of my drawer, my sermon drawer there at my desk. Very back folder. And God reminded me where it was. And I still don't know what it's about. I'm not sure how I'm going to conclude all of this. But I'm going to step out on faith, okay? I'm going to step out on faith and tell you the story that God told me to tell you. And the story itself is about two frogs. You see, there were once two frogs that fell into a tub of cream. Now, two frogs end up in a tub of cream. I can't tell you. I don't know. That's a story in itself. But two frogs fall into a tub of cream. Now, they're in there struggling together. One of the frogs looks at the other one. Then looks up at the high sides of the tub. And determines that the sides are too high, they're too difficult. And so he gives up. And he turns to the other frog and he says, it's hopeless. With that, he then chooses to allow himself to sink to the bottom of the tub and he dies. But the other frog, he's determined to keep kicking and swimming for as long as he can. Something might happen, he keeps telling himself, and it did. You see, as he kept kicking, as he kept swimming in that tub of cream, suddenly it began churning. And it began churning up and up, and before long, that tub of cream had turned into a solid platform of butter. And that frog was able to leap out to safety. So imagine, because at this point, with all this, now you're expecting me to ask you this question. So what direction is your faith calling you to go to in your life today? But that's not it. That's not the question that God is asking us. Now, I believe the question he wants to know is this, that in your life, when you find yourself in a tub filled with cream, do you have the kind of faith that lets you sink to the bottom and die? Or in your life today, when you find yourself in a tub full of cream, do you have a faith that helps you to keep on kicking and keep on swimming until the cream turns and you are standing on a solid foundation? But you're standing on a solid rock of Jesus himself. Which one of those best describes your faith today? Do you want to have a stronger faith? Do you want to know where you're going in your faith today? Well then, ask God to give you the faith that you want. To trust in Him. To know that you have a God who is willing to be there to make that journey with you. And He made that journey for us. He made His own journey of faith when He went to the cross to die for our sins. But also now, He can walk and give you that strength for you to be able to give God your weaknesses. To have a faith strong enough which you can step to the side and just watch God go to work. Do you want a faith that reminds you that God accepts you just as you are? And that He will use you if you trust in Him? Or are you going to just keep going through life sinking to the bottom of the tub? The choice is now yours today. So what will it be? And so I'm going to invite Jim and Beth Ellen to come on up. And our closing hymn is softly and tenderly, Jesus is coming. We'll sing the first two verses of this beautiful song. And He's calling today. But not necessarily a call for salvation. Maybe He's calling you today into a journey of faith. And to trust in Him to keep kicking, keep swimming, keep churning those waters. Because you know that God, something's going to happen. Or like I said, you can sink to the tub of cream and miss out on it all. So Jesus is calling us today. What will it be for you and me? So let's sing our closing hymn. Number, it's 348 in the books, but softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling.
Softly and tenderly.